to chat about getting ready for winter and then basic slips and trips in the workplace. My name is Flint Walton, Missouri Employers Mutual. I'm over in the Safety and Risk Services Department. I've been over here as a technical services and training specialist with the company for approximately 19 years, so working on 20 at this point. So why are we talking about slip, trips, and falls today? What we really focused on is reducing or eliminating these type of injuries within your organizations, and also then hopefully the direct impact to your losses, the direct impact costs, and then also indirect costs to your organization. As mentioned, if you have a question or something, please put that in the chat. I think you will have an option for all panelists. So in case I don't see it, one of my coworkers can flag me down if I've blown past something. You will get a copy of the presentation today sent out to you afterwards. Missouri Employers Mutual is Missouri's largest work comp carrier. Got a ton of safety people within our organization, and their duty is to do what? It is to help you and your organization. So we're going to, like I say, we'll review some common strategies to reduce and eliminate these type of injuries in the workplace. So again, MEM has been around for 25 plus years in the business, pushing safety, and we're going to keep pushing today. We do have a zero accident philosophy. And what that really is saying is that if you intentionally do things and you don't like the outcome, that doesn't make it an accident. It's an incident. So if, for example, in this picture, a business owner has, obviously this facility's been in operation many years, and obviously every time, you know, the temperatures change and there's moisture on the roof and it comes down the downspout, all the time we have ice across the sidewalk, exposing the workers and the general public in this business owner's property. So we need to actually address that and deal with it so it isn't just a constant hazard. So that's what we're trying to work at. And let's chat a little bit about the costs of this stuff, because yes, we want to reduce the pain and suffering, but there's also impacts to the organizations on their claims history, the frequency and severity of claims, impact upon experience modifiers. And mercifully, in general, slips and trips, you know, on the same level, we're not talking construction today as far as falling off roofs per se, but what we are focusing in on is, you know, the same level types of situations. So here are just some facts and figures. This is a few years of claims history, and what does it actually look like? So if you have a worker that's injured, the first example there, they've slipped and tripped on some type of liquid, you know, water on the floor or grease or something in the workplace that they've slipped on. Our typical claim, if the worker doesn't just hop right back up and instead has to have a few days off, is around $22,000. And in today's world, another thing that's troubling, I put down the average loss work days. And 27, that's pushing basically a month out of work. I don't know how your employee group is doing as far as maintaining. I know we have some municipalities here, so hopefully they're stable. But a lot of the other entities I see on here, turnover and getting quality employees is critical. So that's a big cost. Then you look at this second one, $31,000, typical slip, trip, or fall on snow or ice. The numbers are up, the number of days away from work. You know, a lot of us have slipped on the ice. I understand that. We pop up, we dust ourselves off, we look around, make sure nobody saw us. But then there are also those injuries where they, you know, there's some type of injury, and maybe it's just a sprain or a strain to an ankle or a wrist, and the worker doesn't miss any work days. And if that's the case, great. We don't even want that to happen. But there are times when we have, you know, broken bones. I had an employee working for me several years ago, young, mid-20s, and at her apartment complex, spiral fractured her leg, an extremely active and healthy person. And her medical bills were far in excess, just the healthcare bills were far in excess of that. So that's what we're focusing on. Slips and falls on the same level, 26,000 again, 30 plus days away. We see a lot of injuries on stairs, you know, $28,000 on average. And then there's the, in the world of insurance, there's also the miscellaneous category where things don't always fit perfectly. But look at some of the totals. I mean, for MEM, we're largest carrier in the state. We're running an easy $20 million in losses a year coming from these type of injuries. So the point of that is there's a lot of frequency to these. They may not always be the big dollars, but there's a lot of frequency. I mentioned big dollars, and the big dollars are actually out there. So here's just an example of a handful. You know, I know we've got some contractors in here. So here we've got a construction worker just walking back to his truck, slipped on the ice, fell, hit the lower back and tailbone. Obviously, significant injury, significant time off work. Total claim cost, $923,000 on this incident. If we slip on the ice and we suffer broken bones, broken hip, or kind of the worst case scenario is a head injury, and we have had those situations where unfortunately the employee is never able to come back to work because there is actual brain injury, and unfortunately the worker was never the same again. The second one there, it seems a little bit out of pace with the presentation, but you need to be thinking about some of this stuff. I know we've got some municipalities where we're finishing up the lawn mowing season across all the parks and everything. We had one where somebody slipped on wet grass and basically the foot went under the lawnmower, $823,000. Another worker bending down to pick something up, lost their balance, fell down the stairs. So we've got a lot of injuries, probably head injuries involved in that. Seems like simple things, little quick mistakes. Somebody tripping over a hose hits their head. So is that a housekeeping issue? Slips and fall in a cafeteria and fall, $700,000. We have had fatalities in school districts in the lunchroom from, if you will, the lunch lady trip over a cord and unfortunately strike her head and died a few days later. So it is always a possibility. Employees just walking and slipped on something, $600,000. Walking across a parking lot, slip on the ice, $500,000. There is a lot of money in that. That will negatively impact your experience mod, negatively impact your loss ratio. And that could impact the pricing or the availability of insurance potentially. So we want to control that. But the real reason is also what? Minimize the injuries, eliminate those to the employees, have them working for us. A slip there. So let's talk a little bit. What's a slip? What's a trip? So a slip is when you almost think of you know, stepping on that proverbial banana peel or that water on that slick floor, the foot slides forward. And some of these are one of our most dangerous accidents because we fall backwards. And when we do, we saw one or two of those in the losses earlier where we're striking the head, the tailbone. We're looking at, you know, potentially serious injuries involved in it. And again, it doesn't happen every time, but how many times out of 100 does it happen? You know, and there's the trip. So obviously a staged photo in our office here in Columbia, but there's something there that stops the foot from moving forward. And meanwhile, the momentum of our body carries us forward. Foot doesn't come along with us. We stumble and we may fall forward. And that's where we then put the arms and the hands out and might suffer, you know, wrist injuries, for example. So then you just look at something so very simple like this as this entrance to a business owner's facility. You know, just that one board is sticking up, and that's the thing that could easily trip up an employee or a member of the public and cause them to fall, especially if they weren't watching where they were going or if they were carrying something and had their vision obscured or the lighting wasn't good. So we're going to talk about some of those things to try and help improve our operations. So what are some of the main causes of the injuries? So poor housekeeping. We understand slip, trip, and falls, poor housekeeping. We've got something that's cluttered. We trip on something and we fall. We understand weather where we either have ice, rain, snow, things like that. In the food service world, we see the spills or things leaking in manufacturing a piece of equipment, oil's leaking or some type of coolant. But also a factor I think is often overlooked is improper footwear. We're not wearing the right footwear for what we're doing that day. So we'll spend some time on that. And then common sense stuff, surface issues, you know, gravel, potholes, loose rugs. Again, poor lighting. We just simply can't see what's going on. Missing handrails. We'll see some pictures of that. The handrail is there to actually, you know, help you along. And if you do stumble, then you can catch yourself. Without the handrail, you don't have that option. There's actually Toyota of America has a policy that you have to use the handrails within their corporate headquarters and their facilities. And if you don't use the handrail, you could be fired. Why is that? Because of the seriousness of injuries that can occur simply on stairs. And then poor behaviors. I'm not really going to dwell on this one today, but that's the kind of the common sense stuff of, you know, running, horseplay, things of that nature. And then again, stairs, lack of handrails is a common area. So here's simply a side entrance to a policyholder of ours in the past. And you just look at this and you see what? You see, hey, it's wintertime. They did a fair amount of getting most of the stuff away from the building, but everybody's tracking everything in. And how are we dealing with the rest of this? Could we not have had the sidewalks clear? Could we have mats and stuff like that to assist with getting the snow off our shoes or our boots before we enter and drag that into the facility? So we're going to spend some time on that, but you could easily see this becoming a serious injury, not only in the parking areas, sidewalk areas, but then bringing that problem into the building. Here's another one I took a few years back. You know, we do see that they have ice melt on the steps, so that's good. We do have some recognition of hazards, but I have no handrail. I'm not sure of the lighting in this situation. And then because it's this time of year, we've got all the leaves that are blowing around, and leaves, wet leaves in and of themselves are slippery. So they've got multiple things going against them in this picture. Unfortunately, they should probably be out there periodically and getting those leaves out of there. I've got incident investigation down here. And in part, what we're looking for is what is going on within your organization? Do you know what's happening? Have you looked at the losses and loss history? Have you done an in-depth look at what was actually going on in that slip, trip, or fall incident? We need to see the trends. We need to see the locations. Some of the folks on here today have multiple locations. You know, I see several cities. Well, the buildings, I mean, it's the exposures for police and fire is different than, you know, building maintenance versus trash removal, for example. So are we looking at the shoes? Do we have a footwear policy? We'll spend more time looking at that, but do we have proper footwear? Were the soles in good condition? Was the floor wet? Did we have water on it? Was this outside? Was it raining? Did we have snow or ice? Try and figure out what are the contributing factors and try and dial these down into our favor. What can we do to help identify the hazards, implement controls, and have that in place before the problem occurs? And then, you know, lighting, carrying objects, but again, more in-depth analysis, try and figure out where the location is or what the issue is within your organization. And then we're going to try and build policies and procedures around that to help reduce or eliminate those items. And then, you know, yeah, you need to look at the severity. I mean, yeah, there are times when there are slip and fall issues, which are minor. There are some that could have been catastrophic And likewise, how often is this likely to happen? And then the big thing is, are we correcting these? Are we implementing solutions and reducing or eliminating future concerns? So it sounds kind of silly, but we need some basic policies in place. So an inclement weather policy where we look at, you know, the outdoor surfaces. So one of the big things there is just, you know, the parking lots, the sidewalks, the stairs. You know, do we have cleared items for the snow and the ice prior to most of the workforce arriving? I see a message there from Miss Arlene. I will get you some materials as well on that. And if anybody has any requests for stuff, you can certainly contact me. You'll see my email was up there earlier. It will be at the end of the presentation as well. So just email me and I'll try to get you some resources also. But how do we deal with this stuff? So do we contract everything out so we have no snow removal or ice removal that's done by the employees? Do we do it all ourselves? Or do we do a blended approach? You know, that's going to depend upon your organization. If you're going to contract it out, then the question I have is, how do you know that your facility is going to be addressed in a timely fashion? What's the contract? What's the agreement? I've been to business owners during snowstorms, and the place, unfortunately, is not taken care of when asking them about snow removal. They say they have a contract, yet, you know, they're number 25 on the list of 50 customers that person has today. And I know we have one business owner on here today that does landscaping and then also snow and ice removal, you know, for clients such as yourselves. So that's a challenge. You know, how do you prioritize those customers? What is the start time at that individual location? Can we get all this done in a timely fashion? If you're performing, we used to perform all the snow and ice removal at the MEM office by ourselves, our own internal staff. That's a lot of work. That's a lot of time. That's a lot of early hours. That's a lot of employee exposures. It's a lot of snow moving equipment. It's a lot of equipment to maintain. It's a lot of long hours on ugly days for those gentlemen that were doing that service, you know, within our organization. So since then, we've gone to a blended approach. So the big heavy stuff, as far as this main parking lot, that tends to be done on a contract basis. The sidewalks tend to be handled internally, where we have a little bit, you know, we can handle that type of square footage, if you will. So look at your organization, look at the contractors that are available in your area, look at your ability and the workforce to maintain this type of equipment. And you're going to have to make a decision and move forward on that. You know, there's some years where contracting it out at a set fee per month and it doesn't snow, that probably was not the best money spent. Other years, it may be the best money spent. So, but we have to have a plan in place and we have to have it inked well ahead of time. We can't be calling one of our policyholders and say, hey, I want you to just start snow removal for me when it's just in the forecast now. I'm not saying you couldn't try that, but you really need to have that done well in advance. General thoughts are walkways. If you got 4 or less inches of snow, a lot of times if your staff wants to, if they can get out there with push brooms and easily push that off. If it's super wet snow, that may be more difficult. We might need to be using shovels, blowers, or other mechanical means to get that off of there. And we also need to be coming back behind that with what, salt, sand, and ice melt to help deal with that freeze, thaw, freeze cycles that we have every day. Where is the salt and the ice and whatever material that you're going to be using? Is it strategically located within your facilities, or are you in a big production push and it's all buried behind product and you can't get to it? Do we have people who are set up to be the ones to perform the work in certain areas, whether it's their building or maybe they only cover one particular entrance of the building that they're tasked with? but are they designated? Do they have what they need to deal with that? And likewise, are employees encouraged to apply? So at our office, we've got, and you'll see pictures of some of this stuff later, but we've got little ice melt station. So facilities is handling that. But if I go out there and I see that it needs some more, there's nothing stopping me from getting a little bit and treating that, taking that positive, proactive approach. And then obviously, anytime snow removal is done, we probably need to be documenting that. And it may sound silly, but sometimes the sand or the salt can almost be excessive. And so after its use is fulfilled, we need to probably be out there cleaning that up so it doesn't create its own slip and trip hazard for our employees or customers. Another one to think about, and this is again, that strategy on how we're dealing with, especially let's say heavy snowfall, where are we putting the snow? Where can we put it? Do we have to have it hauled off, which is a much greater expense? But what we want to avoid is pushing the snow basically uphill where then it melts, because it's going to melt, and then refreezes across parking lots or across walkways. So how can we place it strategically on our property so that it doesn't cause future problems? I've seen it where we pile up the snow and then you can't see to get in and out of the parking lot. So it creates another hazard. Or they're like, hey, Flint, that's a great idea. Let's move it where the drains are. And then what they do is they freeze up or they block the runoff. Locate the piles so that fire protection, I've seen this where we limit access to fire department equipment, or we cover up the fire hydrants. And this is just an example of pushing the snow uphill. It then melts and it runs down across the walkway and poses an additional hazard to the employees. And then it will continue to do that until that pile of snow is gone. Snow days. So when you know that there's a weather event coming, and we've seen particularly, let's say, school districts with multiple buildings and multiple buildings with multiple entrances and multiple parking areas, that really this becomes a problem or an issue for that business owner of, okay, if I try and clear all the parking lots, all the sidewalks, all the entrances, I won't be able to do it properly. I won't be able to keep up with them. So what do we need to do instead? Probably have a policy that says what? In a snow event, this is the main entrance you will park in these areas. You will come in through these doors. And what that's going to allow is, you know, your internal staff, for example, to focus their efforts on those primary entrances, make it far more user-friendly to get in and out of the building, to maintain the condition of the sidewalks and the parking areas. For example, our office here in Columbia, we have some employees like to use the north entrance, which is on the lower level, out the ramp on the north side of the building. Well, guess what? This falls in one of those troublesome areas. Why? Because it's sloped. It's on the north side. So it is not getting the sun. It's not melting. It's an uneven surface. The sidewalks move up and down, which are fine on most days, but it's just asking for trouble in inclement weather. So that gets shut down as far as incoming. We're not blocking the exits in case there's an event and the employees need to get out. And we certainly get to those areas when we can. But the primary thing is, how do we get the employees into and out of the building as safely as possible in the early hours of this winter event? So that's some of what we do to help assist in that. Some common problems that we see are those entrances. And if we can have anything like a canopy over that to keep that weather off and allow us to have a mat in there to begin to get that snow off of the workers' feet. So have a canopy system, have an outside mat, which is almost more of one of the rougher ones that kind of scrapes the snow off of your feet. And then ideally, then you have another mat where we're getting some of the remaining debris off. And depending upon the seriousness of the event and how much is being tracked in, you may need another mat behind that to hopefully what you're trying to do is getting the employees' feet dry before they're walking on, you know, linoleum or tile or whatever it might be within your facility, and to minimize the amount of stuff tracked down to the carpet, for example, if that's what you have in your building. Major events, there might be so much stuff coming in from the public or employees that you may actually have to change mats out during the day. Once those mats become saturated, they're not doing any good. The people are still going to have wet feet when they're walking into the building. So we might have to swap those out. Do we have extra mats available? Are we prepared for this? When we're swapping them out, are we drying the floor below there? So when we put that mat on there, that the mat itself doesn't slip. So we've got to have the good mats. We've got to keep them in proper condition, constantly monitor those. I know that's a lot of work on those major weather event days, but I think it's necessary. I'm reminded of a claim I had on one of my accounts many years ago that had a, they were sales, they were contracting, they did installing of things at people's houses, awnings and all sorts of different outdoor things. And they had 10 salesmen, and one of those salesmen went into the restroom and there was a leak or something, and that individual slipped on the floor, suffered a serious head injury, and was out for, I think, 6 or 9 months before they were finally able to come back. Head injuries, rehabilitation, et cetera. And you say, okay, so what's the big deal? Well, that one salesman was the salesman. He was the guy that brought in 75% of their orders. He was just that good. And without him there, everybody tried to make up for it, but they actually couldn't. So do you have the potential of some critical employee within your organization being injured and out? Do you have that maintenance guy that knows everything? And without him, where would you be? Do you have, you know, certain, whatever your operation is there someone that you really can't afford to lose? So what are we doing to keep them safe? And yeah, we're wanting to keep everybody else safe, but you want to also be able to still be in business when the event is over. So that's just a picture showing, you know, we've got water outside on a, oh, it's, you know, kind of a stone or a patio kind of thing. So it's got better traction because it is a concrete type surface. But as soon as that water comes inside on a tile, then it's a slip hazard for sure. So do we have the mats? Are we getting the protection in place? Now check out this picture. You would think that this would be like Anchorage, Alaska, but I was thinking this is Central Missouri area. So here's somebody who is fully ready for winter. So they've got all the bags of ice melt out there. They've got a bag or two that's actually open in that tote. They've got a bag to keep the lid on it so it doesn't blow off or anything. You also see a spreader. So there's a deal in there where they could put that in there and then basically crank that out and spread it out evenly across the sidewalk, whether it's the maintenance custodial people at that facility or an individual employee is empowered to deal with that. So have the stuff available, you know, already have the inventory on hand. Inclement weather and footwear. So there's some simply footwear that just doesn't really work in poor weather. So you can have an inclement weather policy that we're going to have, but you also need to have a footwear policy in a lot of business organizations. So I notice we have people that are doing delivery. Well, guess what? We probably need to have a footwear policy for those individuals moving out and about. We have food service. I know when my oldest daughter, you know, got her job at the local fast food place, they made her purchase herself slip resistant footwear because she would be, you know, behind the counter or in the kitchen, and there's always slip hazards back there. So we need that inclement weather policy, but we also need a footwear policy to go along with that. So if you think about hard plastic kind of soled shoes, they're not good for traction. Leather soled shoes, normal kind of dress shoes or heels, those can work in normal conditions. But once things get wet, they don't provide the traction that we need. Softer soled shoes do. They provide more slip resistance and more ability to actually hold onto the surface. So we don't want to see those smooth soled shoes. For example, my wife is a nurse, so she's got nice, comfortable shoes for operating inside. But winter events, she's got a fashionable looking set of winter boots. To do what? To get to work, get out of the car, get inside in case things aren't controlled. And then once inside, she can have whatever footwear, change into in the facility. So make sure we've got a good tread pattern on those. And then if, these are critical things and you have a footwear policy, you actually need to make sure that it's actually being done and enforced. So you may actually have to inject the employee footwear from time to time, make sure that it is what it needs to be. Of special interest, if you're doing some of this snow removal or sidewalk clearing yourselves, we've got to make sure that those individuals, those frontline employees, at the school district or the city employees that are out there. So not only do they especially have to have good footwear with proper treads, but if it's an ice event, then we may want to have some type of a strap-on, cleat or something, which we'll see on the next slide, to assist them. And you don't want those in the locker in the building. You actually want to entrust those to the employee in their personal vehicle when they arrive on site. Why? So they can put that cleat on in their personal vehicle, have those on before they even set the first foot out onto that, icy sidewalk or parking area. I will put the asterisk on there. A lot of these ice cleats do great on ice. You do not want them wearing those inside onto your tiled surfaces or, wood floors, that type of thing. They will potentially cause damage. So make sure you have the training and education there. And here's just an example of the ones that I have with me in my vehicle in the wintertime. Easily slip those on, easily deal with any ice that I might encounter. There's different ways to deal with a footwear policy. The company could purchase and provide those. So you could say, this is, we're in construction. I want you to wear heavy lug-soled steel-toed boots, and we're going to purchase those for you. That can be expensive, but it's easier to track, and you can have kind of a replacement schedule on that. If the employee is required to do that, they may think that that's too expensive or might be a burden on them, or they may try and purchase lesser quality stuff. So there's kind of pluses and minuses to both of this. And then there is a blended approach, which might allow the employee, some partial reimbursement. For example, at MEM, where I work, they do that. So if we're on job sites, we need steel-toed boots. There is a amount out there that they will purchase up to that. That could get you a basic set. I pay a little more and get a little nicer boot and therefore take good care of those. So you also have to consider employee turnover in these situations. So if you're trying to buy it yourself for the employees, and let's say we're in home health, for example, high turnover, or you're in that retail food operation where you want them to all have slip resistant shoes in the kitchen, you're probably not going to be able to afford that if you have high turnover. Some organizations do the deal where they actually start paying the employee back once they've stayed a certain amount of time. So if they're there a short time, they have to pay for it. If they don't continue working, the employee basically eats the cost. So these all three here would be examples of things that we would not want our employees wearing in the parking lots when in snow or ice conditions. stuff like Crocs, smooth soled stuff, shoes that are worn smooth. It's just not going to work for us. We risk the potential of employee injuries. We need to have little safety meetings with the employees, basically talking about how to walk in snowy or icy conditions. So some of the things that they say, you know, bend the knees, get yourself a little lower to the ground, slow down, spread the feet out a little bit, get a little wider base. You know, this is not the time to be going, oh my gosh, it's cold out here, I'm going to scurry into the office. No, we need to slow down. And one of the things I see all the time is, and I know it's uncomfortable, especially if you don't have gloves and if the wind is super cold, but should we be taking our hands out of our pockets? We're better able to control our balance if we have our arms available to help stabilize ourselves. Slow down, watch ahead, don't be in a hurry. Hopefully we got good lighting, we can see where we're going, we're not carrying anything where our view is obstructed. And are there times where I've gone places and the sidewalk is absolutely covered with a very thin layer of ice? And meanwhile, the grass beside it is covered in ice. But guess what? Which is actually safer to walk on? Might actually be safer to walk on the grass so slowly and calmly. When we're out and about, I see some folks on here that are in delivery operations. Where are we parking? Do we have any controls? Are we working routinely at customer locations where they have really good control over their sidewalks and parking areas? Or do we know when we walk into that customer location that it's always going to be a problem for us? So can we choose where we park? Are there better spots in the parking lot? Maybe I have to walk farther, but it's clear and offers me a clear path to get into the facility. Do the conditions change while I'm there? We shouldn't probably be parking next to this ice flow here, but maybe it wasn't like that when you parked there in the morning. Maybe it was clear. Now the snow started to melt and now it then has gotten cold again. And then we're also again in that time of year where it's starting to get dark too early and employees are going to be going into and out of the facilities in the dark. So do you have good lighting? If they're doing something like home health, do they have a flashlight so that they can see where they're going as they move to different client locations? And, you know, just common sense, we always have to be watching out. One of my coworkers took this picture, you know, at a gas station. You know, you literally step out and there's literally a hole right there in front of you. So we have to be ever diligent. I think a lot of times the employees don't understand that slips and falls are a big issue. So they're not worried or concerned about it. So we'll be talking more later about communication and getting that message out to them to alert them to these hazards so they're aware of it and they're constantly looking for these things. Seems like a simple picture here. You know, it's dry where I'm standing taking the picture. The sidewalk is wet. And then meanwhile, the parking lot in the shade is going from snow to slush to ice. What happens as the day progresses? What is our strategy for addressing these hazards? How are we monitoring that? How are we addressing it and changing and monitoring? And this is just an example of, you know, where we're just wearing the shoe or the boot too long and where we've worn down the cleats on that, the traction part. You know, think of this like having bald tires in winter, except they're on your feet. So we need to have that same type of philosophy. General policy statements. You know, we've got to have basic policy statements in place. It's a good way to ensure that we're doing the right things from a safety standpoint. It's showing that you as the employer are committed to the employee's safety. We've got to make sure that the people that are responsible for different aspects of whatever policy we're implementing know those. We've got to have it in place. We've got to actually follow it. We've got to have that management backing. because if management isn't for this, if we're not going to get the funding, for example, or the management's not going to model the behavior, it's not going to go well. Engage the employees that are involved in the snow and ice removal, get their input, management supervisors. How is this going to work? What is going to work best? Be consistent with your values, you know, constantly take care of the parking lots. For example, we want to get the employees in and out doing their business. Again, everybody on this call has different situations. So you need to be taking that time. If you've got a safety committee or something like that, take the time to look at the different aspects of your organization, the stuff that's occurring on site or off site. Engage the people to try and figure out how we're going to deal with this. Make safety just part of the organization. Get that policy statement out to the employees with the accountability and the responsibility for those individuals working that program. And then we're going to have to start the communication between management and employees so we're all on the same page. So they see that we're all committed and we're going to monitor it and make sure that it actually happens. And then again, obviously, we got to have the resources, because if we have a slip, trip, and fall campaign that we're trying to work on within the organization, and yet we don't have any supply of, you know, ice melt, that's not going to look very good to the employees the next morning when they're trying to make it into the office. Employees that are engaged become more advocates of the system. So if you're asking them, hey, what do we need to do? What do we need to change? They're more likely to be following the policies and the procedures. You know, get those employees out there and working with you. Encourage those employees to have that active role in safety. We'll talk about communication. That's critical that we're all on the same page, that we've got that training, and we all understand our role in this process. I would go to the extent of, you know, if we have policies and procedures, getting that signed off by the employee that they know and understand what their expectations are. And then again, management's got to be modeling that behavior. If you say the back entrance is off, you know, we're not going to do that, and then the supervisor gets in early and comes right on through it, the employees will see their car, they will see their little footy prints in the snow, they will know what occurred. So let's not do that. And then if we've got equipment or anything that helps in this process, we've got to make sure that, you know, the snow blowers are in good conditions, that we've got the fuel, that we've got everything that we need to do this job properly. Somebody needs to be monitoring this, see how things are going. Likewise, within your facilities on just routine slip and falls, are we looking? Are we inspecting? Are we constantly trying to figure out how to improve things? Investigate the incidents, make positive changes. And then when you see those employees doing something right, we tell them thank you for doing a good job. So again, regular safety meetings. As we come up to winter here, we should start to talk about what's going on. If we're implementing new procedures and policies, we need to talk about that. Hey, this is how we're going to deal with snow and ice this year. We want to make it through the entire winter without any slip, trips, and falls out on the job site, in the parking lot, you know, whatever your organization deems appropriate. And then we can't just have one meeting, you know, at the end of October saying, hey, winter's coming, be careful. It has to be an ongoing message to keep that in the forefront. So the employees, I'd like to think we're doing good there, understanding the policies and the procedures. If they need anything to, as far as cleanup and spills within their departments, we're getting that taken care of. We want them reporting the hazards and unsafe behaviors. If we see somebody doing something, we need employees that are willing to say something's going on. And then likewise, if there's somebody injured, they've got to be reporting that as well. Get those suggestions in. If they come to you with an issue, you need to step up and deal with it, because there's nothing that'll ruin your program quicker than an employee that says, hey, boy, the back dock is, it's all iced up. We need to get some more ice melt out there. And then the supervisor pays no attention to that. That says two things. One, their safety isn't important. And two, it also basically says that that employee won't be coming to them with any future hazards. They just will keep it to themselves. So we've got to engage everybody within the organization to be looking out for the hazards. When it comes to slip, trips, and falls, alert them, communicate. We have to be paying attention, watching where we're going, because we never know what. We never know when there could be just that one thing sitting there, as simple as a rock sitting in a parking lot that could turn somebody's ankle, right? It's out there. The stuff happens, and we have serious injuries from that. So not really going to belabor this slide, but, you know your industry. There are unique things. They have on schools, they have a play with purpose policy. And you say, what is a play with purpose policy? Well, there's teachers who are actively engaged on the playground or in PE with students moving around. So set some guidelines on stuff like that. You know, we're not all 18 years old anymore. Home healthcare, they've got special hazards. Food service, cities have anything and everything going on. Contractors, delivery drivers going to different things. And oh, I can't believe I'm saying this in my safety career. Should you have a distracted work policy or a distracted walking policy, which means what? You may actually have to consider saying you can't be walking around playing on your phone. We have taken fatalities at MEM as a result of employee walking and being on their cell phone and distracted. But you know, you look at the home healthcare arena, where you're going to an uncontrolled situation in general, where there's no handrails. If it snows the next morning at this property, the elderly grandmother, the wonderful lady, is not going to get out there and shovel the walk and apply ice melt, you know? It's really unfortunately not going to happen. So how do we protect those workers that are out there in those unpredictable incidents like our delivery drivers? You know, this is a property checklist, which is basically the first time you're out there, you need to recognize the hazards and basically put it in a file so you know what you're up against when you go to that location. So we've got to be inspecting things. We need to routinely go over our own facilities, you know, minimum of an annual basis, go top down, but then more frequently on the more hazardous areas. Okay. Looking at the floors and where the slip hazards coming from. If a machine is leaking, we need to deal with that. If there's uneven sidewalks, then we probably need to work on that. And if we can't do it all today, understand that. But we have to have a plan, a budget, deal with the highest hazards first and work through the facility to improve things. You know, if we see carpets or something that are rolled up or something that's going to catch somebody's foot, let's deal with that. Let's look honestly at our facility and say, how is the lighting? Do we need more lighting, especially winter months, parking areas, sidewalks, moving in and out of our facilities? I see some locations where some of the lighting has to be changed manually. So in other words, when it starts getting dark early, theirs is on a timer and the lights won't come on till 7 or 8 o'clock at night. Well, guess what? It's already dark. We have to have a policy or procedure to deal with those things. We've got to have handrails on the stairwells. They've got to be in good condition. They've got to be properly secured. General housekeeping policies. You know, it's everybody's responsibility to identify hazards, deal with them appropriately. I've been in restaurants where as soon as something hit the ground, the first employee that walked by basically stopped, stood over the hazard, drew the attention of another employee, dealt with it. It was handled very promptly and very professionally. I've been in other restaurants, I'm sure you've seen this as well, something hits the ground, Everybody walks around it. No one takes ownership. That's a cultural problem within that organization. You know, but where are we putting stuff? We're not sticking stuff on the stairs or, you know, leaving file cabinets open or leaving tools or equipment laying where somebody might slip or trip over it. We're keeping the paths clear, the aisles within the building. We're not running extension cords where you know, somebody can trip over those. You know, come up with a long-term solution. I know in construction, you know, we don't always have that luxury, but we have a lot more battery-operated tools. We're not storing stuff blocking the exits. But we've got to have responsibilities. We've got to have a plan in place, because if we don't have responsibility and accountability and communication, the program's not actually going to work. We've got to have that top management that's helping out, that is backing it, that's walking the walk, providing the funding, the training, allowing us to have the safety meetings, and allowing us to take the time to investigate incidents and say, we need to change this particular situation out on the floor. Managers, supervisors really need to be doing the same thing, modeling that behavior, identifying problems. And I think something that gets overlooked is a positive reinforcement. When you see somebody doing something right, actually stop and thank them. That is very valuable. So get the good investigations on the incidents. Don't pencil whip it. Take the time to actually learn from the incident, provide that feedback, get the communication again to the employees and throughout the organization. Don't let this policy or procedure die on a shelf someplace. Communicate it. Make sure that we're getting this out, not just one time, but if you've got a newsletter or an email blast or something like that, put that out there. Get routine reminders. I know, and I was busy doing other things yesterday, but we are working on updating our text blast system within Missouri Employers Mutual. So they were doing a lot of testing yesterday of various scenarios to make sure that the upgraded system is actually working properly, that the messages are proper and they're getting to the right people. But have messages out there, little table tents, you know, in common areas, little posters, and be your advocate for safety of the slip, trip, and fall message yourself, whether you're the employee, the supervisor, the manager, the owner, whatever it is, actually walk the walk and talk the talk. And otherwise, we're at 12:55. Are there any questions this morning, I guess this afternoon, on this? It's a fairly straightforward thing. I think the biggest thing is to recognize the hazard that if your company hasn't experienced anything like this before, that's fantastic. You probably ought to take a look and make sure that you don't have any significant hazards out there, that we're addressing the issues, just because it seems so critical to have to take care of your workers now. We can't be down any employees. There's my personal work email, so please email me. And if you need some sample information, I mean, the internet's a wonderful thing, but we have some things I might be able to share with you as well. There are also a few links out there that will be provided in the resources that are sent out from our website. So appreciate you all attending today. Please watch out for yourselves. Get ready. Start working on it. I don't know what the availability of ice cleats is in today's world, but might be looking at that now rather than later. Otherwise, thanks everyone for attending. And we hope you have a safe day and a pleasant winter with no slip and fall injuries.